السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم
السلام ورحمة الله. كنت الشيخ إمداد الرحمن المدني صاحب زيا راعي فن رفاس principal of مظاهر العلوم as well as the imam in Bo Masjid. So if I could request you please come forward and sit on the stage please. I'd be happy to have you on the stage. الحمد لله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. If we all can send our salam and salutations to our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم by reading اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. ثم ماذا؟ I praise Allah the Almighty and send my salam and salutations to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah. He is one and He has no partners. And I also testify that the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the final messenger and slave of Allah. You see, I had a very long day today, and I'm really tired. But as I was listening to our beloved brother, Abdullah Nu'man al-Madani, may Allah bless him for this soothing and comfortable recitation, which really made me feel good. How about you, brothers? I'm sure you had the same feeling. And these are the source of inspiration, our, inshallah, future scholars and huffaz and leaders of the community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him. He is the beloved son of our Shaykh Imdad Rahman al-Madani, Hafidhullah, who is the principal of Madahir al-Ulum Madrasa, just across the road. May Allah bless him as well. The topic of our tonight's lecture is Islam and tradition. You see, when we look at the masajids in this country, we find many masjids have the names like so-and-so masjid and cultural center. So-and-so masjid and cultural center, like Stephanie Shah Jalal Mosque and cultural center. You have London Central Mosque and Islamic cultural center. So you have the name culture in almost every mosque in this country. So we're quite familiar with the word culture, or you can say tradition. The reason why I was interested to talk on this topic, because I've realized that there are so much confusion around the subject of culture, tradition, and Islam or religion. We have got a big clash between the new generation and the old generation. When I say old generation, I mean the people who have come from abroad, outside the West, and from the Eastern world, perhaps Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, or maybe Algeria or Morocco. And the new generation, I mean those who are growing up here, those who are born here. And so we find there is a gap, there is a miscommunication, and this clash and conflict between the new generation and the old generation. You find that conflict and dispute also within the household. Perhaps one of the spouses came from abroad and didn't grow up here, and one of the spouses grew up here. So you find these disagreements between the couple, husband and wife, or the spouses, due to the cultural and traditional difference and conflict. And this is the reason why I was thinking that it is very important to cover and probably share some knowledge that I have tried my best to learn throughout the last few days. Now, Islam is a unique, unparalleled, marvelous religion due to its affiliation with a unique and unparalleled, marvelous prophet who is named as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the most influential man in the history of humanity, according to the Muslims as well as many, many fair-minded non-Muslims. Islam is a unique religion due to its affiliation and its guidance by a book, the glorious Quran, the living miracle of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A magnet, a source of inspiration and attraction. Many people became Muslims, converted to Islam by just listening to Al-Quran, Al-Kareem. That's how much powerful this book is. So we are unique because of our connection with the book. So Islam is a unique religion. There are many features of this beautiful religion. One of the features of this religion is that it is a universal religion. It's a religion for all entire mankind, as opposed to some of the religions which were territorial, racial, or maybe restricted to some groups, ethnicity and race. Take the example of Judaism. For example, to be a Jew, you have to be born as a Jew. You cannot be a Jew or you cannot convert to Judaism. And even if you do it, after a lot of efforts and try, you will be still considered as a third-class Jew. As for Islam, we give our honor to the people who come and convert to Islam. They take an important place in this beautiful religion. So it's a universal religion. Muslims are living all over the world. It is the youngest religion in comparison with Christianity, Judaism, and Hinduism. Yet it is one of the largest religions in this world. Almost in every European country, it's the second largest religion. It's growing on a tremendous and an alarming rate. So Islam is a religion of diversity. It's one of the most diverse religions. Take the examples, take the evidence from the Holy Quran al-Kareem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Ar-Rum, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن آياته خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف ألسنتكم وألوانكم إن في ذلك لآيات للعالمين. What does Allah say in this verse, in this beautiful verse? He says, ومن آياته, and amongst my signs, we don't see Allah, but we recognize and acknowledge the existence of Allah by looking into His beautiful creation. And He says, amongst my signs, the creation, خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, creation of the heavens and the earth, وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ, and the difference of language. Only in India, people speak more than probably 2,000 languages. Hundreds of languages you take all over the world. Uncountable language. The scholars of language, they say almost in every 3 to 5 miles, the accent of language change. The accent. How we speak in London, people in Scotland speak differently. People in Manchester speak differently. Even in Birmingham, people speak differently. And this difference of language is a sign of Allah. Many of us don't realize. خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأُخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ, difference of tones. وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ, and difference of colors. Black, white, brown, red. The colors, these are all creation of Allah. And through this, we see and recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةٍ لِلْعَالِمِينَ, and in it, there is a sign for the people of the universe to recognize Allah. So now, Islam is diverse. Muslims are living all over the world. There is a verse in Surah An-Nasr where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ, O Muhammad, peace be upon you, you will see, you will view, يَدْخُلُونَ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ, you will see people will enter into the fold of religion, not individuals, but in congregations, in groups, and in nations, people will come to this religion. And Muslims of the early state, they witnessed within only 80 years of time, Islam was conquered almost in every country in the Arabian Peninsula and Middle East, which contains about 22 countries today. And then soon Islam was spread to Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, and there were no Arabs once upon a time. And then soon it reached to Spain, to Europe, Turkey, and other countries in Europe, as well as Islam reached to Pakistan, Sindh, India, and Bangladesh, Indonesia, Malaysia, states in China, today they are Muslims. So Muslims came and entered and embraced Islam, but they came from different backgrounds, traditions, and cultures. The cultures of the people in Nigeria is way or maybe very different to the cultures of people in Bangladesh. And the cultures of the people who live in France, in America, and in the United Kingdom are different to the people who live in Asia. So we have difference of cultures and tradition. There is no problem. when people are living in a society and they have a custom and tradition to follow, and they want people of one race, there's not much complaint, there's not much clash. But when people come to a mosque like this, Mr. Shah Jalal, and you find people are praying, they're from Nigeria, they're from Somalia, they're from Pakistan, they're from Afghanistan, they're from Guyana, they're from America, you see people are here coming from different backgrounds, diversity. People are from different ethnicities, and this is the uniqueness of the religion. But when the cultures get clashed, how do we deal with the problem? How do we, you know, tackle the problem, the clashes of cultures? Now, we have two extremes that I must confess amongst the Muslim community, or amongst the Muslim people, generally in the world. You have one group of people who are saying that we don't believe in culture. We don't believe in culture. We don't believe in tradition. Or these are just cultural things. I don't want to know about this. My parents are too cultural. You know, these elders, the uncles are too cultural. So you have got one group of people who are denying and rejecting the culture, forgetting the fact that they're somehow affiliated with some cultures. May not be Bengali culture, could be British culture, may not be Algerian or Moroccan culture, or could be French culture, but somehow we have some culture. What do I mean by culture? It means a set or a way of acting that people in a particular society or group have continued to follow for a long time. So something has been going on, and it has been passed from generation to generation. Like many Christians today, if you ask them, why are you Christian? They will say, it is because my parents are Christian, and therefore I'm a Christian. This is tradition, because it's been passed on from generation to generation. If you ask a Hindu, why are you Hindu? He will say, because my parents are Hindu, and so therefore I'm Hindu. So that's how people would say that, you know, I'm doing this because my parents are doing it. Why do you wear certain clothes? Because my parents and my family, they're doing it, so therefore I'm doing it. Why do you eat curry, for example? Because I'm learning from my parents to eat curry. Or why are you eating couscous? Because I'm learning from my parents to eat couscous, or maybe pasta, or pizza, whatever it might be. So obviously food are also connected with the culture and custom and tradition. So you have people who are denying and rejecting the tradition and culture completely. And perhaps most of these brothers and sisters who are probably right at the beginning stage of Islam, that's my observation. Those who start practicing Islam at the beginning, you'll find people will kind of reject, and I think this is due to the lack of probably knowledge, or maybe due to the lack of expansion of the horizon in Islamic knowledge or Islamic science. But on the other hand, you find another extreme, that people will come and say, you know, we accept everything. Every culture, whatever comes, inherited from parents, we take them. And we accept them and we practice them. And new examples you find in our social events. Take the example of marriages. What do people do? I don't even understand all the complications in marriage. The weddings. You have so many stages, it's very hard to keep up. And some of our youngsters, they get confused. They get even lost. They come and ask, like sometimes Imam, they come and say, what do we do in marriage? Even though Islam simplifies the marriage, it makes it simple. But people make it very sophisticated and complicated. People fail to understand, especially youngsters. And I know brothers who wanted to get married and who were really eager to get married. But because of the complication in our culture, they got put off and they even left home. They're not even living with their parents anymore because of the amount of complication in marriages. So there's lots of cultures involved in our social events when it comes to marriage. You go like, issues like guyhood that some of our people do. And this is taken so seriously. And if you speak to people like, why do you do this, brothers? They'll say, oh, how can we forget? How can we leave them? You know, it's just difficult. You have to live in society. And I understand. And I say that if we want to see our Islam, then we have to check our social events. How we are in our family events, in our marriages, in our dealing and transaction, and the events that we do, the ceremonies that we do, the parties that we have, that's where we can see where how much Islam do we have in reality. So, two extremes. The first A, rejecting any culture and just denying everything. And B, you have people who are accepting anything and everything and trying to practice and catch them and keep them as part of their tradition and culture. And so we have these two extremes. Now, what does Islam say? What is the Islamic stance on the subject matter? There is a famous principle amongst the scholars of fiqh and scholars of Islamic law, jurisprudence. They say that al-aslu fil ashiya'i ibaha. Our sheikh can correct me if I'm wrong. Al-aslu fil ashiya'i ibaha. What does it mean? Please listen carefully and attentively. They say that originally everything before Islam is allowed, permissible, everything is allowed, originally. Until we find a text from Quran and Hadith to say that this is haram, or this is prohibited, or this is makruh. So we can't say, for example, I'm using microphone now. If you come and say like, you know, why use the microphone? Then I would ask you a counter question, why shouldn't I use the microphone? Why shouldn't I use it? So you say, it's haram, or it's makruh. You will say, for example, and I'll say, what's your evidence? What's your proof to say it's haram? Because originally it's allowed. But you have to prove it to say it's haram. You have to prove it to say it's makruh. But otherwise, it remains allowed, permissible. Now, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he arrived in Mecca, the people of Mecca, their cultures, their local tradition and customs, in Mecca al-Mukarramah, in Medina al-Munawwarah, did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam fight everything that Arabs had? Did he get rid of everything? Did he combat everything the Arab cultures had? Or the Arabs had as the culture and part of the tradition? Do you know any brother? Can you please help me? Did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam fight every culture that the Arabs had?
No.
Any idea? Not everything there. Jazakallah khair. Not everything was fought by Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He kept certain traditions as he found and understood that it goes with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he rejected and got rid of the cultures that he understood that they're not and they don't go what they know go with they don't go with the will by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he accepted and kept what was beneficial for the human beings. Maslahat al-Nas, what was beneficial for vast majority of people, and what was accepted by Quran and the Quranic injunctions, Quranic commandments. And he got rid of the things that were harmful for people, and they were against the Islamic faith, the creed of the Muslims. So he got rid of them. I want to give some examples, inshallah, and that will make this subject clear. It will clarify the what Prophet Sallallahu kept and what he got rid of. And so, based on that, we can understand how we go about with our culture, how we should tackle the problems of culture, and this may reduce some of the tension that we have in our society, that we have in our families, that we have in many sectors in society. So, example number one, what Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept in the Arab tradition, in the tradition of Mecca and Medina, in Hijaz, that the Arabs before Islam, they would love their guests. They would be very hospitable. Something they would boast about. They would really be proud of the beautiful hospitality, generosity. And some of the Arabs even said in their poems, poetry, they said, Firashi, Firash al-Dayfi. That my mattress is my guest's mattress. It belongs to my guest. My bed belongs to my bed. Belongs to my guest. Wal baytu baytuhu. My house belongs to my guest. My house, it belongs to my guest. Walam yulhini anhu ghazal muqanna'u. And to serve my guest, my beloved wife, partner, couldn't disturb me in serving my guest. وَحَدِّثُهُ إِنَّ الْحَدِيثَ مِنَ الْقِرَىٰ. And he said that I talk to, converse with my guests. وَتَعْلَمُ نَفْسِي أَنَّهُ صَبْرٌ. Because talking to the guests, like nowadays, when the guests come home, you know, we tend to not speak to them. We just go onto our phones and we're busy, occupied with our tabs and phones and everything, especially the new generation. But the Arabs at that time, they would say, we talk to our guests, communicate with them, involve directly in conversation, because this is part of the hospitality. Dhiyafa, husn al-dhiyafa. So we talk to our guests. وَتَعْلَمُ نَفْسِي أَنَّهُ سَوْفَ يَجْعَوْ. Even though we knew, even though we understand that he wants to sleep, she wants to sleep, but we just talk to them, you know, because we love to speak to our guests. So this is the hospitality amongst the Arabs. What did Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do? What did he do? He even came and emphasized more, and he said, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفَهُ. Whoever believe in Allah and in the next world, in the hereafter, then he must be generous and kind and hospitable to his guests. فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفَهُ. This has been connected with our iman, with our faith. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you believe truly in Allah and his messenger and in the next world, then be kind and generous and hospitable to your guests. So this is a culture Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he loved and he kept. Take the example of certain dress code. You know the Arabs, before Islam, they used to wear turban. They used to pagri or imam. They used to wear turbans, Arabs, before Islam. And even today, you find it is a part of the custom in many countries. Even in Egypt, in villages, people wear turbans. They may not be Islamic, they may not be religious, but still wear turban. You see certain dress like thobes. When you go to some of the countries, the people wear thobes. Even though they may not be religious, but they still wear it. Custom and culture. People back home, we find they wear kurta Punjabi. In Bangladesh, for example, people may not be Islamic, but still wearing the kurta and Punjabi, wearing longis. And some people, they even wear hats before they, when they go in front of their father-in-law. They say, you know, it's a part of the culture that you have to be respectful to your father-in-law. So they wear a hat. They wear a kufi before they go and present themselves in front of their father-in-law, part of the custom and culture. So Arabs, they had the tradition of wearing the imama. And today, even up until today, Sheikh can confirm, there is a turban which is still used in Medina, especially in Haram, the Bilad al-Haramin, in Mecca and Medina, they have a turban, special turban they wear. And so this has been a practice of the people. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he kept it. And he used to wear it most of the time. And even he appeared in many, many battles and programs and different public appearances with the turban. And many scholars considered that as sunnah, even though some say it's part of the ayada, like a culture, tradition, but many, many scholars, they consider this as a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If anybody wears, then he will get reward for that. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept it. And you find many, many things like that. He kept and he got rid of certain things and he kept certain things. People used to wear the beard. They used to have beard as well. But Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, grow it. But people used to have beard even at that time. But he said, grow it. And he said, like, you know, if you have mustache, then shorten it. So people had certain cultures, but Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he directed. So these are some examples. He kept the culture. But at the same time, many cultures he fought and he got rid of them. Take the examples of At-Tiyar. Arabs before Islam, they used to have something called At-Tiyar, that they used to bring a bird. Like today we do Istikhara. You are confused, you want to make a decision. And you don't know which path to take and which decision to make. So you do Istikhara as Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prescribed and recommended. But Arabs at that time, instead of istikhara, they would bring a bird and they would put the bird here. If the bird goes to the right, then this is a good thing. They would say, oh, this is, we're lucky, fortunate. And if the bird goes to the left, then this is bad, bad omen. This is omen. So that's how they decide what to do. If the bird goes right, good, left is bad. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he came and he prohibited. He said, it's not allowed. He didn't allow this to happen. Take examples of Kahana, the fortune tellers. So Arabs, and even today, we have people that, you know, some people who have no, who lack the knowledge and probably culturally influenced, that, you know, if they don't know anything, that what might happen in their life, they would go to somebody. They would go to someone known as the fortune teller. In our Bengali language, we say gonokh. So they go to them and they say, look, you know, I have these problems and difficulties, what do you think? So he would say, this will happen, that will happen, you know, it would be probably good, or maybe he would say bad, and people take them as source of evidence, and they really, you know, accept them. This is hard because nobody knows the knowledge of unseen. Ilm al-ghayb. Accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and accept what he told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he told something to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew. But if he didn't tell anything, even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know the knowledge of unseen. But this culture has been prohibited by the religion, Al-Quran and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, going to fortune tellers and asking them for, what might happen and to predict and what may happen or may not happen. This is not allowed. It is as if you're going to somebody and asking him to tell you the knowledge of unseen. But many people, unfortunately, even amongst Muslims, we have this culture that we do this, but we have to be careful. So also the sihr, the magic, the black magic, this was quite normal before Islam as well. People do black magic to do certain things, to make certain things happen, seeking help from shaitan, from devils. But when Islam came, Rasulullah prohibited. So cultures and traditions were permitted, and cultures and traditions were prohibited by Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's how the examples continue. Now, not everything that we have in our culture is bad. We need to understand this. This is a fact. We may be Bengalis, Pakistanis, or Arabs. We may have certain cultures we bring. But not every culture that we have is bad. We need to understand this. And not everything that we have is good as well. Certain things are praiseworthy. Like, I give you an example, the respect for elders is much more higher in the Muslim world, in the Eastern world in general. You go and see some of the people, children in Bangladesh. I don't mean to offend anybody here. We have good children here as well, alhamdulillah. But comparatively, when we go back home, we see children, or even the youth, youngsters, tend to be more respectful. They can stand and offer the seats for the adults. And they may not be Islamic. They know probably, they don't even pray maybe, but they're respectful to the elders. Guests loving, they may not be religious, praying salah or anything, but when the guests come, they're very, very focusing and they're really concentrating on their guests. Again, where does this come from? From the culture. The respect came from the culture, which you cannot teach theoretically. You can't teach from books. So certain cultures are good. But at the same time, you have certain things, cultures, which are considered as bad. Take the example of forced marriage. Like we have in many cultures, that the parents or the family would force, no matter what, the children to marry to a certain place or a specific place. Did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accept? No, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the choice, and he even said, like, the children should be consulted. Because it's a lifelong contract. Take, even it makes sense. If you reason, and if you think like logically, it's a lifelong contract. So how can you tie a knot without speaking to your people or children who are actually going to get married and they will be living the life? But on the other hand, the excessive love marriage is not also accepted, in my view at least, because it's based upon emotion. And anything that's based upon emotion, it can go wrong. Because when people are emotional, they don't think for themselves, they don't think fairly. They don't think justly. When you're angry, you don't think correctly. Even Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you are angry, then don't judge. Don't make a judgment if you're angry, because you'll make mistakes. So when you are very angry, your decisions are not accepted. When you are in a very emotional moment, when you love somebody so much, excessively, again, you can go wrong, because you're not thinking fairly and correctly. Why do you think some of the people, they consider the prophets to be the sons of Allah? Partially because they loved them so much. The Christians loved Jesus, peace be upon him, Isa alayhi salam so much that they raised his status from the manhood, from being a man, to the son of God, son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal-iyadu billah, which is a great insult to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah doesn't like this, you know, it's something that he hates the most. Al-ishraqu billah, the associating partnership with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So love, excessive love can make, take people to mistake easily and errors. And similarly, when you're very upset, when you're very, very, very upset and sad, again, this can be also a source of mistake because you're too upset, you don't know what you're saying. Some of the women, when they're very upset, they'll deny everything. They'll say you didn't do anything for me at all because they're very upset, frustrated. So emotions are not considered as the right status to make a firm or correct decision. So therefore, in my opinion, even the excessive love marriages also can lead to many mistakes. So people should think and make the decisions wisely and intellectually before taking anything. But what I was trying to say is a forced marriage that we have in our society in many, many places, that even the parents go and just choose somebody without even talking, without even asking. If the children are okay with it, alhamdulillah, it's no problem. If children say, okay, we are fine, then that's by all means fine. But if the children say, you know, we need to also know what's going on, then this is their right. Prophet ﷺ gave them this right to a husband or to a bride or a groom. So we see again it's part of the culture and also reject it. Some cultures, we as Muslims, we must be open to learn. Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Hikmat Dhallat al-Mu'min, that the wisdom and knowledge is a lost property of a Muslim. And wherever they find, they're the first people to go and learn, take it and accept it. So as for Muslims, when we travel across the world, we become cultured, we learn more, we tend to deal with each other better. You see, when we are here in London, some of our elders, some of us when we go back to Bangladesh or maybe back home, we see people in villages. So these are people in village, very narrow-minded. Why do we say it? Even us, Lord, we say it. Why do we say it? Because they're living in a place and they're not mixing with other people. But when we mix and travel and go around the world, we see other people and we become more cultured. We tend to understand each other better. You see, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hujurat, لِتَعَارَفُوا يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ O mankind, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى Verily, we've created you from men and women, from masculine and feminine. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلٍ And we've made you into tribes and nations. لِتَعَارَفُوا So that you may recognize one another. Identity. So that you may know one another. So you may learn about one another. لِتَعَارَفُوا تَعَارَفُوا is to get to know each other. لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ Verily, the most pious in the sight of Allah is the one who fears him the most. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ So we learn more and we understand better and we learn the adab of other people. Imam al-Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi said that تغرب عن الأوطان في طلب العلا. He said, go and travel and be a stranger and seek in the path of knowledge and seek knowledge. وسافر ففي الأسفار خمس فوائد. Go and travel because in traveling there are five benefits. And he said, تفرج هم, releasing the tension. You know, you become stressful. Why do you think people travel? I need a holiday. Even though it's not something that a Muslim always depend on, because the source of happiness and inner peace is from Allah. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But people do need some time. So he said, تَفَرُّجُ هَمِّن وَاكْتِسَابُ مَعِيشَةٍ The second benefit is that you can find different avenues of income. May establish a business. How many people came to study in Saudi Arabia and Egypt and they set up business as well? While they're studying, students, they've done. وَعِلْمٌ Knowledge. You probably never found in your place, you'll find in another place. Every place has its own speciality. وَآدَابٌ You learn the etiquettes and mannerism. You learn the etiquettes of different people and become cultured. وَآدَابٌ وَصُحْبَةُ مَاجِدِي And you find the company of the good people, company of the righteous people and great people that you probably haven't found in your society. So we learn from each other and we respect each other's culture. So we find certain things in our culture which is not right and we find other culture which are really, really good. I give you two of examples, inshallah, and I'll be inshallah concluding, and we leave the floor open for questions, and maybe we can talk and participate more. That would be better. In this culture, we have certain things good. We must agree and admit and acknowledge. There are many, but I'll say one. Entering into someone's house or room or an office, you have to knock on the door, don't you? You have to knock on the door before you enter into the office or someone else's house or room. In this culture, it's it's taken seriously. If you just enter into someone's office, then it's rude. It's taken very seriously. We find this in our Eastern world or in some of the countries, the people don't take that seriously. People just get into the room without any permission, without any asking, without seeking any permission. Just enter, and that's it. And people even take it offensive. People think it's offensive. If you tell them, you know, why did you ask me to come into the room? People find it, who the hell are you to tell me, you know, if I should come to your room or not? People become really angry and frustrated. And we have that a lot in our Bengali culture, I must confess. We have families living in one house, maybe multiple families. Maybe two brothers are married, maybe one brother, one sister married. So you've got multiple families living in one house. But I've seen many people coming and complaining that the other families or brother-in-laws or the sister-in-laws or maybe some members of the family, they don't ask before they come to our room. They just come in. And we don't want to be seen and exposed to them the way they come and see us. And they become angry if you tell them, please knock on the door before you come. We find this complaint by many people. And so what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this tradition that we have in this place, it goes with Quranic direction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَدْخُلُوا بُيُوتًا غَيْرَ بُيُوتٍ حَتَّى تَسْتَأْنِسُوا وَتُسَلِّمُوا عَلَى أَهْلِهَا. Or you believed, do not enter into the houses of other people until you have seek their permission and you said salam to them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes to the extent that he said, if you don't find anybody at home, or if you are probably denied the access for any reason, that could be a valid reason, then just go back happily, and that is better for you. But that doesn't mean that we just close the door in front of our guests all the time. No, and we have to be hospitable and kind. But the situation may arise that we may not be able to see at a time. And people should accept the apology. People should be understanding. Allah says in the Quran, you take the permission before you enter. If someone says, okay, I give you the permission, absolute permission, then that's fine. It's about the understanding of each other. But if someone says, look, I need some privacy, so please respect that. And especially if the brothers and sisters are living married couple in one house. And I found many of our people don't tend to respect that. And they even take offensive. They say, you know, how can you tell me to enter into house, into the room? It's that you're rejecting me. You know, there's nothing to be offended here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that privacy is needed. And so you find certain things here good and we can take. Take example of queuing up. And the one, like the good discipline. You go and stand in a queue. Take on the base, you know, priority base. And this is again good. It's not support anything that is good. Whereas we find in our culture, in the Eastern world, there's no queue. Whoever goes, if you have power and strength, then you're the first one to be served. So service is based on your family, your status, who you are, and your body strength. If you're a muscle man, if you've got some muscle, then probably you can just push him and do it. Get your job done. But on the other side, we have people respecting the queue, and that's a good thing. But again, as I said, in our culture we find certain that is good, and we should take them. Take the examples of hospitality, being respectful to our elders, being kind and generous to our youngest. That you find in some of the traditions and cultures, and that's how we can, inshallah, help each other to reduce. The way we can minimize the cultural clashes and traditions, clash of tradition, is number one, we try and align ourselves to the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as much as possible. Because Sunnah is unified. It has been legislated due to its universal approach. So therefore, Sunnah of Rasulullah can be applicable, I think, more than anything else, you know, the most and maximum. So Sunnah of Rasulullah, the more you align yourself, you tend to be cultured by the culture of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that can reduce the problems, you know, if not all, but a little bit, it can reduce. And then also, we tend to learn each other's culture. So the elders should also learn the children's culture, those who grew up here, without just rejecting, oh, these are just youngsters. They don't understand anything. And on the other hand, the children say, oh, our elders don't understand anything. These are just chachas, they don't understand much. And so, wife is saying to her husband, you came from Bangladesh, you don't know much. And the wife is saying, husband is saying to his wife, you know, you don't know about this country. And we have racism within ourselves, Bengali people, we have racism. Now, every, you know, you might say, how do we have racism? Do you know the word says freshie? How many of you use the word freshie? Many of us use, many children. This is a racist remark. Racist, and racism is prohibited in Islam. You know, we don't understand sometimes what you're saying, but to say freshie, you're trying to say that this person doesn't understand and you feel somehow you're superior, you're more better than them. So this is not right, but some of us will make that, you know, remark, the racist remark. This is not allowed. We have to respect each other's culture. So elders should understand the young, those who grow up, because culture is very deep, profound. People will fight. People will fight for the culture. People can start fighting, believe me, just based on the cultural difference. It's nothing to do with Quran and Sunnah. You see, in Bengali culture, or in probably some culture of the world, even in Malaysian culture I've seen, that touching the feet to anybody's feet or maybe like your body is a big offense. You have to apologize, stand and apologize properly. But in many cultures, it's very normal, taken very normally. It's very normal thing. So what? You just touch my feet, so it's no problem. But people can go to the extent that they can start fighting based on that, because the lack of the gap, you know, of communication or the gaps of cultures. So when we understand each other, we turn and learn to respect each other. And this is the most important thing, and first and foremost, we learn and understand. And then we start respecting each other. So we as young youth, we respect the culture of our elders, and the elders also respect the culture of our youth, because we cannot just get rid of them by talking and by fighting. So finally, my conclusion of this lecture would be that anything that is good and for the benefit of the people can be accepted in terms of tradition and culture, and anything that is harmful and goes against Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah and the opinions of the Sahaba and our Salaf predecessors, then they're rejected. And that's how inshallah I'd like to finish this humble talk. Inshallah, if you have any question, you may ask, related to the topic, obviously.